Assalamu alaikum. So today we will continue the discussion on the domain theory. In last lecture we discussed a problem that why the entire cluster of iron does not organize itself as a single domain. So today we want to answer this problem, this question. We know that from thermodynamics that every system wants to minimize the free energy of the system. Let every structure take up the configuration for which the free energy F is equal to U minus Ps is a minimum. Means that the free energy can be minimized either when the entropy of the system is very high or the internal energy of the system is very small. So in this way we can minimize the free energy of the system. But we know that in case of the magnetic materials have a high degree of order. So it means that in this case we can neglect the entropy term, and so we will focus on the internal energy term here. Means that the free energy will be minimized by minimizing the internal energy of the system. And we know that the total internal energy of a domain structure in a ferromagnetic material is made up of different contributions. That is, the final domain structure is decided by the competition between different types of energies. The first one of these energies is the crystalline energy or anisotropy energy, whereas the second term, second type of energy is the demagnetization energy, which is also known as the exchange energy, and the third one is the domain wall energy, and finally the magnetic structure energy. So that total internal energy of the system is decided by the competition between these four different types of energy. So let's discuss these energies one by one. First discuss the crystalline energy, which is also known as the anisotropy energy. In ferromagnetic materials, it is easier to magnetize the magnetic material in certain directions, which is known as the easy axis, whereas it is harder to magnetize materials in certain other directions, which are known as hard axis. So the anisotropy energies can be defined as the preference of a magnetic moment for orientation along a specific direction with respect to the lattice is known as the anisotropy energy. And there are three different types of anisotropy energies. The first one is the magnetocrystalline anisotropy, the second is the shape anisotropy, and the third one is the stress anisotropy. Now for the cases where the magnetic moment prefer any of the cubic axis and not through any angle, any other angle of the material, this is the case of magnetocrystalline anisotropy. That is, it is easy to magnetize the material along these axes, whereas it is harder to magnetize this material along any other direction. So this is the case for the magnetocrystalline anisotropy, and there is also the anisotropy because of the shape of the magnetic material, such as if you have a magnetic material in the form of a thin film or a nanowire. So in this case, shape anisotropy is important, and the magnetic moment will prefer to lie along the plane direction and not normal to it. And similarly, in this case of a wire, the magnetic moment wants to lie along the long direction and not the transverse direction. Whereas there are some cases where we have a spherical kind of particle. In this case, the situation is different. Because we know that in such cases there are some atoms which are in the interior of the system, and there are few atoms which are on the surface of the atoms, and these surface atoms they have distortion because they are unable to reach their minimum state, and whereas the atoms which are in the interior of the system, they are in their equilibrium state. So in this case, the surface anisotropy is there. So these are different kinds of anisotropy which can exist in the system. Let's discuss more about the magnetocrystalline anisotropy, for example, for the case of iron and nickel and cobalt, in which iron and nickel have the cubic structure. And we can see here that for iron, 100 is the easy axis of magnetization. That is, it is easier to magnetize the iron along the 100 direction, whereas 110 and 111 are the higher directions of magnetization. And similarly, for the case of nickel, 111 direction is the easy axis direction. And whereas for the case of cobalt, which has a hexagonal crystal structure, cobalt has a uniaxial anisotropy, and the hexagonal axis is the direction of easy magnetization at room temperature. That is, the C axis, which is along the Z direction, is the easy axis of magnetization, whereas the basal planes, which lie in the XY direction, are the hard directions of magnetization for the case of cobalt. Let's discuss about the origin of magnetocrystalline anisotropy. Basically, magnetocrystalline anisotropy has its origin in partially quenched orbital moments, which then lead to the interaction between these magnetic moments and the crystal electric field. And hence, the orientation with respect to lattice leads to different energies. That is, what I meant to say is that the magnetization of the crystal sees the crystal through the orbital overlap of electrons. That is, the spin interacts with the orbital motion by means of spin-orbit coupling, and then the spin, that is magnetization, interacts with the lattice. So for the case of cobalt, the anisotropy energy density is given by uk is equals to k1 sin square theta plus k2 sin 4 theta, where theta is the angle of angle the magnetization makes with this hexagonal axis, and whereas at room temperatures, k1 is equals to 4 into 10 is power 6 Hz per cc, Hz per centimeter cube, and k2 is equals to 4.1 into 10 raised to the power 6 Hz per centimeter cube. So if this angle of if the angle which the magnetization makes along the z-axis is very, very small, so we can, in this case, we can neglect this the second term, since the sine 4 theta is nearly equal to theta 4, so the dominant term is the sine square theta term. So here the uniaxial anisotropy for the cobalt will be equal to uk is equal to k1 sine square theta. So if we plot this uniaxial anisotropy given by k1 sine square theta, we will have a graph like this, which will be positive in both the positive and the negative quadrants. And that is, this is the place where the energy is minimum, and at theta is equal to pi by 2, the energy is maximum. So this is the easy axis of magnetization, whereas this one is the hard axis of magnetization, or we can say that this amount of energy is required to make the moment this way. So this is the case for cobalt, which has the hexagonal crystal structure. Now let's come to our second type of energy, which is known as demagnetization energy, or also known as magnetostatic or exchange energy. We know that the interaction energy which makes adjacent dipoles align themselves is known as exchange energy or the magnetic field energy. That is, let us suppose that the exchange energy which is responsible for the adjacent dipoles to align themselves established a single domain in a specimen of a ferromagnetic material. And because when a single domain is formed, the magnetic poles will be free. So because of the free magnetic poles formed at the surface of the crystal, this configuration will have high energy, which is given by square over 2 mu naught. I will also show that how this energy is high because of the free magnetic dipoles, but graphically as well. So we can also say that, in fact, this is the energy required in assembling the atomic magnetic moments into a single domain. And this work, which we do in assembling a single domain, is stored as a potential energy in the field outside this single domain. So let's discuss this point graphically, that when the exchange energy has established a single domain within a ferromagnetic specimen, we can see that in this case the magnetic dipoles magnetic poles are free. So there will be so one end will behave as a north pole and the other end will behave as a south pole, and so there will be large flux density which is extending beyond this single domain specimen. However, we can see that when we divide this specimen into two domains of opposite directions, so we can see that this magnetic energy which extends outside these domains is reduced to half. And similarly, we can reduce it more if we divide the specimen into more domains. That is, we can reduce this flux density which extends beyond this specimen by dividing the material into many domains. Here we have shown other domains as well, in which there is zero magnetic field energy which extends, and that is, there is no field which extends outside these domains, and such domains are known as closure domains. Hence, now we can see that the domains are formed to reduce the energy associated with the large flux density entering beyond the magnet into free space. So if the whole specimen which turns into a single domain has one direction of M, then this energy is called the demagnetization energy, magnetostatic energy, or dipolar energy, which is given by ED is equals to minus mu by 2 mu naught by 2 into integral of M dot HD into dV, where HD is the dmag field and V is the volume of the specimen. And since in this case M is uniform and is opposite, and the dmag field is opposite to that of M, so HD will be equal to minus N times M, where N is the dmag factor. So putting the value of HD in equation 1, we will have this equation. And now, since in this case M is uniform, so this M can come out of the integral, and we will have the dmag energy which is equals to N mu naught M square V over 2. So this is the dmag field which is present inside a ferromagnetic specimen. So now let's come to discuss about the third type of energy, which is known as the domain valve energy. So before going to discuss this type of energy, let's discuss first that that there are different types of domains which exist in a ferromagnetic specimen. And the most common domain valves are 180 degree and 90 degree domain valves. That is, if the moments are oppositely aligned, then if the moments on the neighboring domains are oppositely aligned, then the domain valve is called the 180 degree domain valve. And the most common such domain valve is known as a block valve. Whereas similarly, the 90 degree domain valve separates the domain of perpendicular magnetization, and the most common domain which has a 90 degrees is known as a nail valve. So here is the graphical representation of the block valve, that it separates domains of opposite orientation, opposite magnetization. Similarly, there is the representation of the nail valve, which separates two domains of perpendicular orientations. Here is the extended version of the block wall and the kneel wall. And the essential idea of this block wall is that the spin direction in going from one direction to the other does not change abruptly in a single step. Rather, this change is distributed over many steps. And similarly, you can see here also that this spin change from one direction to the other does not occur abruptly. Rather, it is distributed over many steps. And the reason for this gradual change is the fact that for a given total change of spin direction from the exchange from one direction to the other, the exchange energy is small when the change is distributed over many spins than when the change occur abruptly. So in order to save or minimize this exchange energy, and this motion of spins from one direction to the other occurs in many steps. But also there is one energy which is increasing when the change is distributed over many steps, and that energy is the anisotropy energy, because when that spin direction is changing from one direction to the other, there is some component of spin which is directed along the hard axis. So it means that the block wall thickness will be decided by the competition between these two forces, that is the exchange energy and the anisotropy energy. The fourth type of energy is known as the magnetoselective energy. It is known that when a specimen is magnetized, it is found that it suffers a change of dimensions, and this phenomenon is known as magnetostriction. This deformation is different along different crystal directions. So if the domains are magnetized in different directions, they will either expand or shrink. This means that the work must be done against the elastic restoring force. The work done by the magnetic field against these elastic restoring forces is the energy due to magnetostriction, or it is also known as the magnetoelastic energy. That is, if the crystal is not strained, we can say that magnetoelastic energy is zero, but usually the lattice is strained along different directions of magnetizations of domains. So that's it for today's lecture, in which we'll discuss the reason that why crystal of iron does not have a single domain and divide itself into many domains. And this is because of competition between different types of internal energies of the system, which we have discussed in this lecture. So in coming lecture, we will find out the domain wall thickness, as we said that that the domain wall width will be decided by the competition between the two forces, that is the anisotropy energy and the exchange energy. So we will discuss the domain wall width, and we will calculate the domain wall width in the next lecture. Thank you.